Our reading today is from chapter 23. Well done for persevering, those who have been through every week so far. This is week 6. And in chapter 23 we have the last words of David. I'm sorry, that's page 326 for those who are hunting. 2 Samuel chapter 23, reading verses 1 to 7. These are the last words of David, the inspired utterance of David, son of Jesse, the utterance of the man exalted by the Most High, the man anointed by the God of Jacob, the hero of Israel's songs. The Spirit of the Lord spoke through me. His word was on my tongue. The God of Israel spoke, the Rock of Israel said to me, when one rules over people in righteousness, when he rules in the fear of God, he is like the light of morning at sunrise on a cloudless morning, like the brightness after rain that brings grass from the earth. If my house were not right with God, surely he would not have made with me an everlasting covenant, arranged and secured in every part. Surely he would not bring to fruition my salvation and grant me my every desire. But evil men are all to be cast aside like thorns, which are not gathered with the hand. Whoever touches thorns uses a tool of iron or the shaft of a spear. They are burned up where they lie. Well, nice short passage to finish up with this morning, but do please keep your Bible open. And let me pray before we begin. Heavenly Father, as we come to the end of this series, as we reflect perhaps a little bit on what we've learned over these past weeks, we pray that once again you would draw our hearts to the Lord Jesus, that we might more fully appreciate him with thankful hearts. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. I want to ask you just for a few minutes this morning to think about things that make you go, ah. I'm not talking about the doctor kind of say, ah, so I can look at your tonsils. I'm talking about that little sigh of deep satisfaction that we have every now and then. The way we react if we're human to the little joys of everyday life. As Mitch mentioned earlier, he did have to take his mother and father-in-law to the airport through the week. Lou and I flew down to Sydney for a couple of days during the week. And as we dragged our little overnight bags across the road to the terminal on their bumpy little wheels, I turned to Lou and I said, ah, it's a good feeling, isn't it? It's like somehow the burden of routine just lifts off your shoulders because you're about to get on a plane. I don't know how planes do that to you, but going somewhere different. Ah. Or the smell of the ocean breeze at Cronulla Beach while the afternoon sun lights up the heads on the waves. Simple pleasures. Things that remind you how good it is to be alive. A decaf piccolo latte at Grind Cafe just up from the beach. Ah. Friend was telling me the other day about his rose garden. He trims them, he waters them, he tends them, and he says it's all worth it when they bloom. He says as you walk out in the garden, you smell the wave of the scent. He said, there's nothing quite like it. Ah. So what's yours? Think about it. In our little passage from 2 Samuel 23 this morning, David, did you notice, gives us two things that make God go, like that. Two beautiful images, but they're being used as a metaphor for one thing that's even better than all of them. Something that makes God himself sigh in satisfaction. Pick up again from verse 3, have a look. The God of Israel speaks, the Rock of Israel says to David, when one rules over people in righteousness, when he rules in the fear of God, he is like the light of morning at sunrise on a cloudless morning. Ah. He, the one who rules God's people rightly, he is like the brightness after rain that brings grass from the earth. Now, do you get the vibe of that? If you've ever been up early enough to enjoy the first fresh beams of sunshine on a cloudless morning, if you love that, then you'll really love this. If you love that crisp feeling after an afternoon rain shower when the grass is looking greener than you've ever seen it, then you are going to really love it when a ruler of God's people rules over them in righteousness. God himself thinks that is delightful. Hope you do too. But here's the thing. I do want you to notice those are carefully chosen words. My team of Hebrew scholars, namely Jeremy and Pete in the office, tell me that the original Hebrew text is just as carefully crafted to make sure you see there's no specific subject to that sentence. It's a series, in a sense, of unattached participles that are purposefully talking in the abstract. It literally says, ruling over Israel in righteousness. Well, that's terrific. When one rules in righteousness, if someone were to rule God's people rightly. If you ever see that, you'll love it. But if you think King David himself qualifies for a statement like that, well, that's a bit of an open question, isn't it? It's interesting, we're told at the start of the section these are David's last recorded words. Sir Isaac Newton figured out gravity and the laws of motion and other science stuff that had everyone baffled. Here are Isaac Newton's last recorded words. He said, "I don't know what I may seem to the world, but to myself I seem to have been only like a boy playing with pebbles and shells on the seashore while the great ocean of truth lay all undiscovered before me." Rather humble last words. What about the great artist Leonardo da Vinci? Apparently he said on his deathbed, "I have offended God and mankind because my work did not reach the quality it should have." I guess the Mona Lisa, you know, not quite good enough. It might be unhelpful perfectionism on their part, but it might actually be genuine humility. In other words, I know my own heart, I didn't amount to much. So here is David, king of Israel, last words, saying when a leader rules over God's people in righteousness, it is just delightful. Do you reckon that's his verdict on himself? Now, this is the last talk in our series, so let me give you just a quick recap on the second book of Samuel to help you decide. This is the king, I'm sure you remember, we saw back in chapter 11, lounging around on the roof of his palace while his men went off to war. And then he sees Bathsheba bathing as he looks down on the neighbouring houses. And he liked what he saw, remember, and he desired. And so he took her in exactly the pattern that defined the first sin back in the Garden of Eden. It's Genesis chapter 3 all over again. Is that a king ruling righteously in the fear of God? Of course, that's not all. When she tells him that she's pregnant, he sends her husband, Uriah the Hittite, to his certain death on the battlefield. Is that a king ruling righteously in the fear of God? We saw in chapter 12, the prophet Nathan rebukes him, "The sword will never leave your house." Then chapter 13, David's son Amnon rapes his half-sister Tamar because he likes what he sees and he takes it. King David does nothing. Well, I mean, of course, what could he say? He's done more or less the same thing himself. So younger son Absalom takes revenge on his brother. "The sword will never leave your house because of what you've done to Uriah the Hittite in stealing his wife and killing him." We saw Absalom, chapter 14 onwards, leading a coup against his dad. David in exile from Jerusalem in the wilderness, at war with his son until Absalom is brought down. Of course, David still loves him. So it is a tragedy of epic proportions as David's wailing for his son pierces the night. "The sword will never leave your house because of what you've done to Uriah the Hittite." We saw David at last fully penitent, but still living with the consequences. Which brings us then to these final four chapters, which are curiously arranged kind of in pairs around a central idea. You get two stories of judgment in the last four chapters of 2 Samuel, one at either end. Then you get two lists, battles where David gradually seems to be wearing out, and another list, the names of his mighty warriors. And then you get two poems by David right at the centre. We're focusing on the second one of them this morning because, as I said, they are David's last words. And what's the verdict on whether David qualifies as righteous ruler of God's people? Just one little hint in case you're wondering. Little reminder, we're not going to spend time working through the list of David's mighty warriors, his loyal men who give everything for their leader in the rest of chapter 23, but just glance down again at the final name in the list at the end of chapter 31. Let's have a look at the end of the list of David's mighty men. Recognise him? You reckon it might be there to give us just a little reminder in case our attention has wandered off. You get all those other guys near the end of the chapter, like Zeleg the Ammonite, Ira and Gereg the Ithrites. Then you've got this. The loyal and honoured mighty men of Israel who David cheated of his wife and sent to his death with a secret letter in his pocket to General Joab saying, "The king says, put me in the front line so I die because he's been messing with my wife." The last name on that list, just to remind us, just to bring it to mind as we come near the end of the book, David's mighty men, and the last of them, Uriah the Hittite. With a king like King David, who needs enemies? See, what's your verdict on the life of David as he comes to his last words? God's verdict is, gee, it would be good if there was a king who would actually rule over my people in righteousness, who would fear me enough to do the right thing. It'd be wonderful to have a king like that. And the fact is, it has not been King David. But look, here's the thing. Come back to that little section, David's last words. Because, you see, all is not lost. And here is the great hope that runs like a thread right through the history of Israel. The hope, you see, is not just in King David. The hope is in his house, in his dynasty, in the line of his descendants. That's his last word. Not that it's going well so far, but see, God has made a promise, and it's that promise back in 2 Samuel chapter 7 that we saw that's driving things forward. There is a sword hanging over it, but there is a promise that remains. Let me remind you of God's words. You might remember David wanted to build God a temple, a house for God. But God says, you're not going to build a house for me. I'm going to build a house for you, a dynasty that is going to last forever. 2 Samuel chapter 7, verse 16, God says, your house and your kingdom will endure forever before me. Your throne will be established forever. That was the deal. That was the contract. That is the famous covenant with David. Which is why David now says the words here in his final poem, in its final lines. It is God's promise. That's at the heart of David's last words. His hope is not in himself. It's in his house. It's in the future of his dynasty. Pick it up there, chapter 23, verse 5. If my house were not right with God, surely he would not have made with me an everlasting covenant, arranged and secured in every part. Surely he would not bring to fruition my salvation and grant me my every desire. But you see, he knows his house is established with God in every way. This is a rolled gold, rock solid agreement. This is the reason why anything that's gone right has gone right. This is the reason that, in a most unlikely way, in the book of Kings, the next book, his son Solomon is going to succeed him, son of Bathsheba. Out of bad will come good. And from him a line of kings who finally lead to King Jesus. Verse 6 and 7, he says, evil men are going to be cast aside like thorns and thrown on the fire like rubbish. But David's line, but David's house, he says, the deal is wrapped up. And there will be a king who rules rightly. You know, across the two books of Samuel, 1 Samuel and 2 Samuel, there are 40 chapters devoted to the warts and all story of King David. And if it was a movie, I reckon you'd come out of the theatre kind of shell-shocked, feeling flat, sad. Because in the end, it's been so unsatisfying. If you're an old-time movie buff, it's kind of like Bush, Cassidy and the Sundance Kid. Remember the ending of that? Thelma and Louise. David, such a flawed character, so very disappointing. Except he knows there is the promise of a sequel where it's all going to turn around. You see, friends, from where we sit, we've seen the sequel as well. We have actually seen how good it is to see the kind of leader David can only dream about. It's interesting, the Old Testament is kind of like a book of heroes, but they are always, without exception, deeply flawed heroes. You can go back through every Bible story you might remember from Sunday school, and the story's the same. Abraham, awful. Moses, a mess. Samson, a disaster. King Saul, gonged off after the first round. David, disastrous. And the almost odd thing is their failings are preserved for us in excruciating detail in this holy book of Israel. You know, ancient Greek art, it was always idealised. Their statues, every blemish removed to show what they thought in a sense was the perfect essence that lay behind our human imperfections. The Bible is unscrupulously honest, or scrupulously honest, as it's like an ultra-high-def TV screen. It shows every blemish in detail. Of course, that's us as well, isn't it? The Christian blogger Tim Challies posted a quote the other day. He said, "There is no such thing as a great man of God, only weak, pitiful, faithless men of a great and merciful God." Change that quote to be gender inclusive, because women, you know, are equal opportunity sinners as well. What's true of David is true of you and me too. Over and over again, all of us fall into that same old Genesis pattern. We look, we see all kinds of things that are pleasing to the eye. More money, more success, more lifestyle options, more sexual satisfaction. And of course, it's operating at every level in our culture, every level of our society, every level of our families, every level of our own hearts. We see, we desire, so we grab for it with all our power. So everything becomes all about me all the time, what I want. Bernie Sanders is the guy they say is the most unlikely Democrat candidate in the US election campaign. And he's making waves. They keep having to hire bigger auditoriums to accommodate the crowds. Because, for one thing, he's pointing out constantly how the wealthy have so much influence over the media. He says, they are very, very powerful. And many of them, he says, are extremely greedy. "For the life of me," says Bernie Sanders, "I will never understand how a family like the Koch brothers, worth $85 billion, apparently think that's not enough money." Well, it is a fair bit, isn't it, $85 billion? But how much is it going to take for you to think you've got enough to be satisfied and be generous? For me, money, of course, is the single biggest way we see and grab to get the stuff we desire. The Bible uses words of us like greed and selfish ambition. They're, of course, the reasons we can never trust anyone in high office. Anyone. Which is why we've got the Crime and Misconduct Commission. Why New South Wales has got the Independent Commission Against Corruption. Why every other state has got something similar. Because we know just dangling in front of all of us is the temptation to just grab what we want. use other people for our benefit. That was David's downfall. So often it's ours as well. Which is why, of course, God says, if you could find someone who would rule over people in righteousness, if there ever was one who ruled in the fear of God, it would, wouldn't it, make you let out your breath in amazement like a sunrise on a beautiful morning. What a beautiful thing it would be. Which is why, of course, the gospel accounts of Jesus are just so refreshing. And friends, I know for many of you, you've found and you've said, you know, 2 Samuel is a pretty torrid book, isn't it? And we've been through some pretty unpleasant stuff. People are saying, why do we need to read this? Well, I guess it's the dark night time before the sensational sunrise that makes the sunrise so spectacular. In each of the 4 gospel accounts of his life, do you notice Jesus never, not once, puts a foot wrong in any way. In anything he says, in anything he does. Every conversation, every decision, every action. You can see the wisdom in it when he's being challenged. You can see the compassion in it when he meets suffering and heals with a touch. You can see the grace in it when he meets failure and sin. Every interaction you read, he is never self-seeking. He is never grasping for himself. He is, in fact, the absolute fulfillment of what a righteous king should be. And let me tell you, that makes God just sigh in delight. Does it do that for you? Even just a little bit? Here is what God says about him. God in person. Matthew chapter 3, verse 17. It's the point where Jesus is being baptized and a voice from heaven says, "This is my son whom I love. With him I am well pleased." Later on a mountain, a few chapters later in Matthew's gospel, Matthew 17, these words, almost the same. While Jesus was still speaking, a bright cloud covers them, Peter and James and John, and a voice from the cloud says the same words, "This is my son whom I love, with him I am well pleased." And then he adds this, "Listen to him." And as you do listen to him, can I say, just take a moment to enjoy what it's like to live under the rule of a gracious king like Jesus. And take a moment to notice and actually enjoy it every time you spot one of his followers actually listening to him and learning to be more like him. And not just being about me, me, me all the time. And so if it just so happens that someone you're chatting to after church really takes the time to listen to you and understand you instead of just talking about themselves, or follows you up when you haven't been around because they care, it should make you go, "Oh, that's delightfully like Jesus." If someone from your church puts themselves out for you to serve you, even if it's just making your morning tea or washing up after you, it should, in a little way, you know, just make you go, "Oh," because they're a reminder of what it's like to live under the rule of a gracious king like Jesus. If someone from your church hears you doing it tough and bands together with a few others to buy a new fridge for you because they know you can't afford it, or hands you the keys of their spare car and says, "Take it," just enjoy that moment like a fresh sunrise or raindrops on the green grass. If you see people like our elders or members of our team, like Mitch you heard from this morning, or your growth group leader serving you, having you in their home every week and caring for you, not because they're in it for the status or the reward, but because they're part of his kingdom. Friends, that is a delightful reminder that we are finally living under the rule of King Jesus. And every now and then you'll catch a glimpse. In our very human and failed and fundamentally broken church, just a glimpse of what it's like and what it ultimately will be like when we see the new creation and his kingdom in its final form. Every time you catch a glimpse, that's all I want you to do after this morning. Just say, ah, and appreciate it, like the golden rays of sunrise or fresh raindrops on the grass. Because you see, 2 Samuel, in all its bleakness, is a reminder of how delightful it is when there finally is a king who rules over people in righteousness, who rules in the fear of the Lord, as God has finally brought about the fruition of David's salvation and ours in our great King Jesus. John's going to lead us in prayer.